All my life, I've always tried to do right by the art world. I feel like the artists are often overlooked, and I feel like the ethical guidelines in the art world are very blurry. So it's very important to be constantly self-reflexive to think about what the right thing is to do. Say, for example, I work with a lot of artists from El Salvador, and their context is incredibly important to their work. And so it's thinking about how to exhibit their work and show what they're wanting to do in the best possible light without thinking or applying preconceived ideas from quote-unquote what the first world would want to see. It's about handling things with a certain amount of respect.
How did you come to curating art?
So when I was much younger, I had finished up my university degree, and I was a volunteer at something called the South African Center for Photography. And I was an assistant to the professor there, who was arranging something called the Cape Town Month of Photography, which was a biennial throughout the city of Cape Town. And he had invited a curator to come down and actually curate it that year, and that person was not able to make it. So he invited two students, myself and my fellow student Kim Stern, to actually curate the biennial. And I obviously knew nothing, but I was thrown in the deep end, and we ended up organizing 150 exhibitions across the city of Cape Town that happened in 1 month. So I really got thrown into it. It found me in a way. And then following that experience, I got invited to be the assistant curator for another art awards that was a South African awards, and I got to travel throughout South Africa and work with a very experienced curator. And that's really kind of how I began to learn. And then I got invited to the Rebel Family Collection in Miami, which is a beautiful private space that has incredible artwork. And I think I learned more there than I did in all of my schooling. And there I did a curatorial internship, and that was really my immersion into the curatorial world.
What did you learn in this institution in Miami?
Well, I think the collection that Mira and Don Rubel have is incredibly risque, and I feel like what I learned was never to feel afraid of what you're showing. And I just love their eye. I think they're absolutely scrupulous, and what I really learned from them is that when you work in the art field, you live, breathe, eat art. It just becomes part of your lifestyle. And so it really kind of instilled in me this idea that if I'm going to do this and work as an art curator, it's got to be something I absolutely love.
What are you looking for yourself as a curator?
So I have found this kind of really interesting niche. I've realized, I think I'm also learning a lot about myself through the process of curating as well, that, you know, coming from South Africa, I come from a very specific background, and I'm a very social being in that sense. I feel that art needs to speak to some kind of a social issue, because that's really the role of art, especially now.
For example?
Whether it be thinking about the role of female artists in the world, whether it be thinking about humanity, the way in which we treat each other, the way in which artists from El Salvador might not have the same opportunities as artists from elsewhere, how trade affects the way human beings live. I feel like there's so many layered themes that affect us on a day-to-day that artists address in fascinating ways that can open our eyes to see things in new ways beyond the news. So I think in that sense, I've been working with these kinds of artists which have a social angle. And, you know, I went to a whites-only school until I was 15 years old, and I left South Africa when I was 24. And although it's an absolutely incredible place, its history is fraught. So I'm now working in another country that has a similar kind of fraught past, and I feel like I'm finding the beauty in the ability of a lot of the artists to transcend that space. And I feel like the language of a lot of creative practice in these spaces is very unique and very special.
Before creating a new exhibition, what are the questions you have in mind?
I'm always thinking about how to make an artist's work accessible to people who might not know about art. I feel that's incredibly important. There is a tendency in curatorial practice to use big words to describe ideas, and I'm not that kind of curator. I feel like there's no need to exhibit in that way. especially when I'm working with artists who might be lesser known within the mainstream, although their work is probably as good, if not more so. They might not be as known, so I'm constantly thinking how to present their work in a way that's going to be accessible, manageable, and incredibly clear. So I think within that framework, it's also thinking about how the message is conveyed. So again, I'm coming from a social angle where I feel like, for example, Peterson Kamwati is an artist I work with. He's based in Nairobi, and he does these beautiful, beautiful charcoal drawings where he addresses the traditions of the colonial ways of being that have been implemented in the Nairobi environment. So, for example, the British system of standing in line, which would be considered a queue, this idea of standing in line has been imposed upon the Nairobi landscape. And so he would draw people in standing in these like kind of long lines. And it's this very kind of ironic play on how people have been taught to behave. So I'm kind of very interested in presenting work like that, where people can kind of relate to it in a way that's accessible. But then there's also that other layer of that other kind of story behind it, which tells the history of how the British went into a place and actually, you know, there's a whole history behind what happened there.
What's your idea about accessibility regarding the public?
I feel like art is a democratic space. It should be a democratic space. I do feel there are different layers in the art world, and I respect that, but I prefer to work in the layer that makes art accessible. I don't feel like there's one art world, I feel like there's many. And for me, working in the sphere where I've never worked for a commercial space, I've only ever worked for foundation spaces, museum spaces, I'm interested in thinking about ways of breaking down the four walls. So I'm always thinking about how artwork, even though it's being shown inside a space, is breaking down the idea of this closed art world. So I'm interested in definitely breaking down that.
Could you correct an exhibition about something you don't like?
I mean, I think like is a... I mean, it depends how you define like. I mean, I don't like a lot of the issues that I deal with. But I don't think I could curate an exhibition with an artist's practice I don't respect. I mean, I have been asked to write about artists' work. But if I'm not on board with the practice, I don't think I could do it, just because it wouldn't be fair to them or myself. And I probably wouldn't do a great job if my heart wasn't in it. So I think it definitely needs to come from a place of heart, and you 100% need to believe in the product that you're putting out.
Is there something that can be taught about curating a show?
I mean, it's such a layered process to kind of answer that concisely. I feel it's really tough, because it's about creating a story. I think it's always about, people shouldn't forget that you're telling a story. So the narrative needs to make sense. I think text is incredibly important. Creating an access point where people can enter the exhibition from a very aesthetic point of view is important at times, just to kind of get people to respond to the work, but then also providing a lot of didactic information so that people can take it a step further. I hate exhibitions that hit you in the face with telling you how to think. That's not the kind of shows that I'm interested in. I want the artwork to ask people and have them kind of get to the point by themselves in a way. So it's about providing as much didactic information as one can, and kind of leading the person to them, but not necessarily hitting them over the head with things. So I like opening that space and creating a space for a person to have an experience on their own. I think that's really important.
Experience, that's the core of what you're offering to the public.
Absolutely, and I think experiences are vital to art. I mean, that's really what we're doing. It, an artwork, you know, the expression, the artwork isn't complete until the audience has seen it. But having said that, I also think that there's a tendency in the art world to want everybody to have a fantastic experience, and that for the numbers to be huge, so everybody has to come and see your show. And I'm more of this kind of school of thought, is that I'm happy for 20 people to come and see the show and have a fantastic in-depth experience and leave with something worthwhile. I'm not interested in thousands. And so I think it depends also on the kind of mindset that one approaches exhibition making with. I'm interested in alternative dialogue to mainstream. So, you know, I curated a show at the Frost Museum of Art in Miami, and I was surprised how many people were really interested in learning about artists that they didn't necessarily know too much about. And so I think people are becoming increasingly curious about new spaces in the world beyond the mainstream art world, which is now being represented largely by art fairs and mega museum shows, and there's a place for that too. It's just not particularly what I'm interested in.
What about the sound aspect of an exhibition? Is it something you're interested in?
Increasingly so. So I'm new to sound, and actually I'm working with Shannon Stratton, who is the curator at the Museum of Art and Design, on a music and photo exhibition that's happening in Bell Harbour next year. And I think sound and creating an experience, I think people are thinking beyond just a two-dimensional framework. So art is becoming much more expansive, you know, video performance. I deal a lot with performance art too, and I think creating alternative sensory experiences is becoming increasingly part of the art world, and I really find that interesting because I do feel like people can have an experience that is kind of transcends the four walls, which is great.
What are the mistakes you try to avoid when you work on a new exhibition?
I feel that sometimes kind of working on the inside of the art community, when you're working so closely with an artist, I think curators risk sometimes imposing their own ideas on the artwork. And sometimes in dialogue with the artists, I think it takes a lot of time, a lot of patience to kind of feel out whether you're pushing it too far or you've taken it in the wrong direction. Because in many ways, a curator is a translator. They're taking the artist's work and they're translating it to the people who are coming to visit the show. And so, you know, lost in translation is not a good place to be. It's really not where you want to be. And I think it takes a lot of time, you know, a lot of speaking with the artist to make sure that you're conveying the exhibition in the best way. So I think sometimes that can be a big oversight. And, you know, exhibitions are also about creating an environment. And so you think about the way in which the wall text will work, the color of the wall text, you know, how you want to frame the room. And I'm always trying to think, okay, am I being too heavy-handed? Maybe I need to take a step back and tone it down so that the artwork really does speak more. Or so it's, you know, it's always like navigating that space and knowing exactly where that line is.
About the sound aspect, about the audio guide, What are the pros and the cons, according to you?
I mean, I don't think there really are any cons. I think an audio guide is an absolutely vital part of the art experience nowadays. You know, it's incredibly expensive for museum spaces or for any kind of space to have guides on call 24 hours. And I think as numbers increase and people want to attend shows and learn more, the audio guide is the perfect way to think about that. So, you know, I think I mentioned I've been working on this public exhibition on our beachfront in Bell Harbour, and we have, you know, a lot of text there, but we also have a lot of people who want to learn more, and we've been thinking about how to do audio tours and audio guides, and we actually have an app that we've just uploaded a lot of information to and a lot of sound bites to in order to kind of guide people and help the experience. But I think audio tours are an absolutely vital part of the art community now and really do provide access to a lot more people than I think a museum would be able to do if they only had staff on hand.
How should the audio guide be used? How do you see that?
I'm not a traditional curator in that sense. I don't think there's a right or a wrong way, and I think it really depends on the show. And what I would love to see increasingly is that the artists actually tell you when they want it to happen. So I feel what doesn't happen is that the artists are not made part of the process of deciding how the exhibition is spoken about. And I don't feel like, say, for example, one show should be before or one show should be, you know, after. It depends on how the exhibition is framed, how it works, and how the artist would want it to happen. You know, I know that the traditional form of an audio tour right now is to walk up to an artwork, I think click in the number of it, and then listen. And that's fine, but I also think it's very interesting maybe if the artist wanted to introduce the show before you saw it or tell you about it after. I think that's really, really interesting, and that almost becomes part of the show. So I would love to see that happen, where the audio tours actually become part of the creative process.
How do you see what an art critic should do?
a critic has the job of providing a viewpoint that's a strong one and that can guide the art world in a way. The critic can give an audience an alternative viewpoint where they can not necessarily go into a show and just accept what they're seeing. So,
like a translator.
Also like a translator, absolutely.
When you have to write about a piece of art, does it change the way you look at it?
Absolutely, yeah. I think with any field, the more you research or learn, it kind of fills in the gaps and you get a much broader vision of things. And I think learning about an artist's practice, not necessarily just from one show or one artwork, really does inform how you view their work. So I think also people are kind of have this general idea that one artwork represents somebody. It doesn't. It's an entire lifetime of work. It's exhibitions. It's, you know, and knowing all of that really fills in how you write about it or how you think about someone's work. And I think that's very, very important.
Can you judge quality in a separate way from your own taste?
That's a great question. That's a great question. And yes, I think you absolutely can. And I think you have to. So I'm much more attracted to certain kinds of artwork that I would want to work with. But I can definitely appreciate the quality and know that it's a really great artwork, even if it's not something I necessarily personally want to work with.
What is this kind of knowledge? How do you explain that?
So I think it's about language. You know, artwork is a visual language. So we're decoding things when we're looking. Just as much as the words I'm choosing to use, you're decoding the way in which you're understanding what I'm saying. I feel like it's the same thing.
So looking at a work of art is like reading it.
Absolutely, absolutely. And then to kind of revert back to my experience at the Rebel Family Collection in Miami, I think that's something that they really taught me was we had to give tours. And one of the first things they taught me was to look at an artwork and to say out loud what I was seeing. And it sounds like such a simple thing, but it's really not. It's a really very difficult thing to do. And so whenever I give tours, and I give tours to a lot of groups in Miami who don't necessarily know a lot about art, and they feel like contemporary art is so inaccessible because it's conceptual, the first thing we do is an exercise where we look at a work of art and together we dissect exactly what we're seeing. So it could be like, oh, I'm seeing a canvas that is 20 by 20. It's a standard size that one bought from a shop. Okay, so the artist is using a standard size, you know, grid. I'm seeing a red line that's been painted across it in acrylic paint. There's one single red line. It's a strong line. What does that mean? How does that make me feel? Why is it red? Why did the artist choose red? And so you start to kind of dissect an artwork like that. And again, it's like reading. It's like, yeah, it's, and then you eventually get to the point where you're like, oh, wait a minute, I think I'm really getting this. And it's much more accessible than you ever thought it would be. And I love artwork that asks you things and asks you to have a moment with it and doesn't necessarily hit you in the face. So I really feel like that moment in between of being able to look at, as you say, a work and start to dissect it and start to have an experience with it is really where the beautiful part of art lies.
But beyond this reading aspect, isn't there something like a presence, just a presence that you can feel?
When we see a work of art, I think it was a dating app that said when you see somebody for the first time, you know if you like them or not within the first 3 seconds of seeing them. The same thing would apply to an artwork. You read those cues immediately because we're so incredibly adept at doing so. So I think when you see an artwork, you can read it immediately, you can have a response, but then what? And that's what I'm interested in. And I think many artists use that as a tool. They know that they can attract a person to their artwork by using visual tools. But then I think a really successful artwork takes you to another place.
What do you expect from a conversation with an artist you're going to show?
The mistake would be to go in with any kind of expectations. I think openness is number one key to meeting an artist and trying to understand their practice. Then again, having said that, I think there's a basic kind of expectation of professionalism, but that's a different kind of issue. That's, you know, them being able to talk about their work in a way or present their work so that you can access it. But I've also found, and this is kind of, I think it harkens back to one of the things you asked me, is that you don't necessarily like the artist that you're going to work with, but you love their work. And I think that's always very interesting because it challenges you as a person to have to value their practice kind of beyond the human being, and that doesn't necessarily sway how you feel about the work. And I think that's a very interesting place to be. And they might not necessarily like you either, you know. But I think working together with somebody when you really, really respect their work and coming out of it just feeling like you've done a great thing, that's the most rewarding thing that one can hope for.
I'm going to leave the space. Please keep the microphone and add whatever you want to the interview.
Okay. So Philip has left the space. I have to say that I'm so incredibly grateful to be able to work as an art curator. I think there's so many fantastic under-recognized artists, and I hope to be able to fill my days with being able to make those steps possible for them to show and make a living from their work. I would find that an incredibly rewarding way to live my days.